Welcome to Good Libations, which is our program about mixology. I'm Ethel Andrews. I'm a mixologist, as we all know. And today in particular, we're going to talk about seasonal drinks, drinks that are suitable for autumn and winter in particular. And these type of drinks that we're going to make today, we could make during the summer also. But we're going to do them in a fashion that would suit the colder seasons with heavier alcohols. And the first drink that we're going to do is going to be a sangria. And again, if we're going to make a sangria for winter and autumn, it's usually better to make it with red wine. And we want to pick a red wine that has some fruitiness to it. Not sweetness, but fruitiness. So usually a Merlot or a Shiraz, as they say in Australia, is the most suitable. And some people like to use sparkling wines for sangrias. And basically, I would not do that simply for the fact that that petalance in a bowl, whether it's shaped like this or rounded out, you're going to lose it. And then you're going to have a flat sangria after a while, which is most unappealing. So yes, you could get a red or heavier champagne, but better to use a still wine if you're going to make a sangria. And this particular one is just a modestly priced Merlot that we're going to use to make this sangria. So we're going to go ahead and start and open the bottle. And sometimes these bottles are cooperative, sometimes they're not. Most people will use the thing on their corkscrew that peels off these, but over the decades I've never had much success with using that, so I just do it what most people would consider to be the difficult way, but it works. Anyway, years ago we used to have nice foil enclosures, but of course now we have plastic ones for the most part, and sometimes even a plastic cork. So we're going to go ahead and dispense with the cork here with our red wine. And in this case, like I said, it's a modestly priced Merlot. And we're going to go on ahead and make a good homemade sangria. And a good homemade sangria should not be overly sweet. In fact, I aim for basically not sweet at all, but fruity in flavor. So I'm going to go ahead and pour it in the bowl. And usually, of course, you would put several bottles in the bowl, but I'm just going to use one because we're doing this just for demonstration purposes. And usually, citrus fruit in the form of oranges and lemons pairs best of all with sangria and berries. So I'm going to go ahead and cut into this orange here, and I'm going to squeeze orange juice into the red wine, because this will add more acidity and that nice citrus overtone that you want in sangria. And then I'm going to add some orange slices to the sangria, mostly for decorative purposes. And you could either do whole pinwheel large slices or fragments of slices, whichever you prefer to do. And again, when you make this in advance, which of course we're not exactly doing today, it'll be able to blend and meld in and infuse with the wine and make it more complex than simply drinking wine. And we're going to do a similar thing with the lemon. We're going to go ahead and give a good hand squeeze to the lemon and get plenty of citrus infusion in here. And then we're going to put a few decorative slices again into the sangria to make it have eye appeal and look aesthetically nice. And usually I caution against lime in sangria. To me, it's odd and imparts a bit of an odd flavor. But you can put berries in sangria. And usually I prefer to put a raspberry in sangria, so I'm going to go ahead and do that. And the raspberries by themselves will macerate into the sangria. You don't have to do anything with them, but they impart a nice flavor. And if you have money to burn in deep pockets, you can use Chambord liqueur, because it's a raspberry-based liqueur. And also you could use a black currant liqueur, because you want to add something to it to give it additional alcohol content and body. You could add a bit of brandy to it. And what I usually like to do is I like to add a bit of triple sec to it, although sometimes I do go the Chambord route. And you don't want to add a lot, but you want to add enough to kick it up a few notches. And some people like to do additional things to it that are not exactly in accord with my taste, but some people like to put cinnamon and nutmeg in their sangria, which I think is very odd, but to each his own if that's what they like to do. Now, another caution too with our sangria is usually people use a ladle, but I'm always into the art of improvisation. If you don't have a ladle, you could use a little measuring cup to dish out, so to speak, or pour out into glasses your sangria. And don't put ice in the sangria, because what you're going to get then is you're going to get a dilute batch to drink. And who wants that? That's no good. So the thing that you want to do before you serve it to your guests is you want to put ice in the glass. And you could use a wine glass for it, or you could use a small footed glass like this one for your sangria, because both glasses have eye appeal and both of them are very suitable. And again, better not to use any sparkling wines, no Prosecco, no champagne, unless you get really, really cheap champagne where they ran carbon dioxide through it, because those bubbles will last, but the other bubbles are not going to last, and you'll end up with a flat drink anyway. So following a proper way of serving it, I'm going to go ahead and put some ice in a glass, and we'll try out the sangria. And also, if you want to use other liqueurs, you could also use cherry herring. There's so many options of things that you can put in sangria. You could use, as an example, too, Kirschwasser. But usually if you put something like cherry herring Chambord or the triple sec or Cointreau in it, it's going to add a certain amount of sweetness, which you want, without an overpowering, cloying amount of sweetness in it. So I'm going to go ahead and give this a try. And again, what you would want to do is make this in advance, you know, like hours in advance, if not a day in advance, so that the fruit can really infuse into the wine. And again, pick a fruity red wine. So I'm going to give this a try here. Just a bit of it. Oh, that's quite good. Yeah, because the fruitiness of the wine comes to the fore, the citrus flavor comes to the fore, the triple sec kicked it up a little bit. What I may try to do is put a bit of brandy in it, like I had talked about, make it a little bit stronger. And during the summer, a lot of people like to make sangrias that incorporate white wine, and that's perfectly fine. But in the winter, for your winter events and your parties, again, you might want to use a red wine, because it really is better. It's more suitable for cold weather versus the hot weather months. And I think it falls on the palate better with whatever appetizers you're serving and whatever meal might follow with your family get-togethers and so forth. And again, you might want to add more fruit. And you definitely will want to let this infuse in advance so the flavors really come through. And you may think, well, you know, you can buy commercial bottle sangrias, and yes, you can, but they're not interesting and they're not particularly individualized. But if you make it yourself, it's always so much better. And what we always like to do with our drinks and cocktails too is add a garnish of some sort. Bit of lemon is always good. Bit of orange is good too. And of course, a nice raspberry makes it so decorative and festive and looking nice for your guests. And I'm going to chop this up a bit more so this doesn't look like a stepchild portion. And we'll see how this tastes now with the garnishes in it too. And yes, that is quite nice. And especially if you don't want to worry about intoxicated guests, a lighter beverage like sangria can be most wonderful for accompanying your meals and your appetizers. So there we go. A refreshing, simple homemade sangria. And again, you can add many different things to it to kick it up a notch and have a little more alcohol content, a little more complexity of flavor than just the red wine. And that way your guests will enjoy it, you will enjoy it, but you won't have gone to a huge measure of trouble. And it's easy. And again, as I always like to say during my shows, we always want to make sure that we keep safety in mind and the reputation of our community in mind too. So let us be sensible in our consumption of alcoholic beverages. Let's not overdo. Let's keep our community safe and well spoken of. And thank you again for tuning into an episode of Good Libations, where we made a very simple drink for this time of the year. And my name is Ethel Andrews again. I'm a mixologist, bartender. And thank you for tuning into Good Libations. Goodbye.